Hello, welcome to this interview. My name is Marianne Kanengiese and I'm very happy to have Professor Dr. Rajeshwari Rapata here with me. She's a famous homeopath. And Rajeshwari, would you please introduce yourself to our listeners?
Yes, I'm Dr. Rajeshwari Rapata. And I have been practicing homeopathy since 22 years. At the same time, I've been practicing, I have been working as a professor in the subject of human anatomy, and I was a dean for 2 years at a medical college in Maharashtra. I was invited by Dr. Mary here for the interview, and thankful for that. I wish you great success in your initiative. So today is National Doctors' Day.
National Doctors' Day in India.
Yes, in India. Wow. So happy National Doctors' Day to you.
To you too.
And it is in commemoration with the former Chief Minister of West Bengal. West Bengal is a state in India. Mm-hmm. So we celebrate as the National Doctors' Day. Do you know that West Bengal is a hub of homeopathy?
Well, no.
Yeah. So homeopathy, West Bengal is the hub of homeopathy, and it is practiced. The National Institute of Homeopathy is also present. It's there in the West Bengal, and many prominent.
Unfortunately, I don't know much about your country.
Okay.
But now I know that for West Bengal, I have to have an eye on it because of homeopathy.
It's the hub of homeopathy. Many famous personalities have come up from West Bengal, and lots of research is being done in West Bengal. And next, after West Bengal, you have Kerala. Kerala also, mm-hmm. Kerala. K-E-R-A-L-A,
I know.
Kerala. Yeah. So there are also lots of homeopathy. Homeopathy is being practiced. Even this COVID-19, you know, the chief minister of Kerala, she is nominated to speak in the UN about COVID-19, how she has controlled in the state of Kerala. And absolutely, it came up to zero figures of no corona patients.
Great.
Thousands of corona were there, but it reduced to zero. So that is one of the honor, you know, for the chief minister of Kerala, teacher Shailaja, she's called us. She is invited to UN to speak on how she managed. So one of the important thing is homeopathy played a very important role. There are many government PHCs, primary healthcare centers, where the doctors, homeopathic doctors, are working on a large scale to control the corona patients, you know. So they are managing it very well, and they have distributed medicines. They have treated individually the patients on the basis of individualization, not like the genus epidemicus. Mm-hmm. They have treated patients, and the cases are also well documented. So Kerala is also playing a very important role here. Basically, our government, Ayush government, Ayush means Ayurveda, Yoga, Unani, Siddha, and Homeopathy, and Yoga. You know? All these together, the alternative systems, the complementary systems, what do you call this? These are traditional systems of India. And these all together, they have formed a government, the ministry, the Ayush ministry. Mm-hmm. So Ayush ministry is the part of the government, you know, the ministries of the government.
Yeah.
The family and health welfare. Mm-hmm. So here, this government is playing a very important role to control the corona through the traditional medicines, through Ayurveda, through homeopathy, through yoga, all these things, Unani and Siddha. So in Kerala, in West Bengal, in all the states, government has introduced arsenic album as the immunity booster medicine. Mm-hmm. You know? So they have named it as immunity booster because compounding all the symptoms there of arsenic. When you look at the anxiety,
yeah,
the fear of death, the restlessness, all these symptoms coming together, they have decided the CCRH of the India,
mm-hmm,
okay, Central Council of Research in Homeopathy, they have decided arsenic album to be given in 30 potency to all the people as an immunity booster so that it will reduce the symptoms. And people have got a very positive result in this this thing. So many people,
yeah,
have got good results. Even those people who have...
Were they treated, yes, when they were ill, or was it prophylactic?
What happens is, it is like a prophylactic only, because we are considering the symptoms, general symptoms here, which is anxiety, the restlessness, you know, fear of death, okay, and arsenic being considered as a broad spectrum antibiotic in the terms of allopathy, if you speak, you know, because it acts on all the organs.
Is arsenic mainly used in the region of Kerala? Is
no,
it a geographical topic?
It is used all over India, and it has been promoted through Ayush Ministry.
I understand.
Through Ayush Ministry, it has been promoted through Ayush Ministry and the CCRH,
mm-hmm,
through the government of India, and it is working very well. It has been distributed to lakhs and lakhs of patients. Even the private doctors are giving this medicine. Many of the NGOs and social workers have also been given the circulars to give this medicine to all the people as an immunity booster.
Mm-hmm.
So many people who have taken it, you know, out of the ratio of 100, only rarely one or two people, those who have been exposed, those who have been working outside with the people,
yeah,
out of those people, one or two cases only became positive. Otherwise, there is no such thing. You know, so it's working very well.
Great.
So, but still, we have some differences here in India. Some people are saying that we have to take the cases individually. And even I agree with that. So, always there are some exceptions. People differ in their opinions regarding the treatment. That is one of the drawback of homeopaths, I think. You know?
Yes, I think because so too. It's an old, yes, quarrel, interdisciplinary.
Yeah. So we always differ in, but that should be a healthily, that should be a constructive type of criticism, or are things which have to be discussed together and not to be placed in social media. We have to just come together, discuss over these points and agree to a thing that which will be agreed all together by everybody. So it should be discussed properly. So there are skeptics, you can say internal skeptics as well as external skeptics. Internal skeptics are those differences in between our own homeopaths, and external are those lay public who don't know what homeopathy is.
Yeah.
And they are just wondering that how it works and how and all. So first we have to clear the differences between us, the homeopaths, who know what it is, what homeopathy is.
This
and,
is a great topic.
And homeopathy, when we say, there are some things because of which this skepticism happens in homeopathy, in between our homeopathic doctors. One thing we can say, the lack of education. So they don't know the basic principles. They don't know they don't know the knowledge of materia medica. They don't know the principles. And because of that, there is a lack of understanding. And because of this, one of the most important thing is ego. That is one of the point. So these things have to be cleared in between our groups, you know. Make them understand. We have one group here in that is called as HHF in Maharashtra. They are doing a wonderful job. You know, those students or those practitioners who have been doing GP since long, even though they are homeopath, they have studied homeopathy, they are doing general practitioners. They are general practitioners. So we are making them aware. We conduct regular CMEs, free CMEs. There are study circles also. And we discuss cases. And we discuss how the treatment is given. We discuss all the successful cases. We discuss the failure cases also. And we come to a point that how that cases can be studied and how. So in this way, even the general practitioners are turning towards homeopathy. Means those who are proper BHMS graduates and who have been practicing GP, those people also leaving their GP practice and coming towards homeopathy, and they are turning to become pure homeopaths because they are witnessing the successful cures. So that is very important point. So what happens in Maharashtra, there are many hospitals where our students, those who are freshly graduated or those people who have been practicing GP since long, they are working in hospitals and they are giving allopathic medicines. They are giving all the modern system of medicine they're practicing, but that is considered as illegal.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and in par with the modern medicine doctors, they are paid less also. But even though they are practicing in hospitals. So this thing has to be stopped, and I think they have to know the importance of homeopathy, and government also should promote the homeopathy to be practiced by the homeopaths strictly. Government, one positive thing is government has introduced one bridge course in the conventional medicine, where the graduates, homeopathic graduates, after doing the bridge course, they can legally practice conventional medicine, modern medicine. That is the thing. So there are so many things. Government is supporting us totally, you know. Mm-hmm. So that is very good point here.
Yeah, you're blessed in India because the government supports you. We cannot say mm-hmm. the same in Europe, unfortunately. And we don't have those educational possibilities as you have in India. We don't have these colleges where you can study 5 or 4 years homeopathy. The only really good school is in Switzerland and was mm-hmm. founded by Dr. Mohinder Singh, who was an Indian too.
Okay, yeah. That's nice.
Yeah.
So that was about the internal skeptics I was talking about, and external skeptics, that is the lay public who don't know anything about homeopathy. You know, so these people have to be made aware of the how homeopathy works, and they should be like we should do medical camps and give them the medicines either by charity or by sponsorship.
Yeah.
Through homeopathic pharmaceutical companies, you know. So those things are being done in India also. So the lay public, many people are turning towards homeopathy. They are really having faith in homeopathy and they are taking medicines. So that is the thing.
How high is the percentage of people who take homeopathy in India?
Percentage is, you can say, about 70% of people are taking homeopathy.
70%.
Yes, 70% of people are taking homeopathy. Yeah. So that's rest, rest of the 30%, out of the 70%, about 20% choose to stay anonymous.
Mm-hmm.
Either due to what reasons, I don't know. Even our colleagues who are the conventional modern medicine practitioners, they also take homeopathy undercovers. They don't reveal that they are taking homeopathy. But they take homeopathy. You know? There are so many of my friends who take homeopathy. They have even given testimonials and they are very happy about the results.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So we have our colleagues also who have been taking homeopathic medicines for their. Some of the my friends who are modern medicine practitioners, they have been taking a homeopathy for 20 and 25 years. Since 25 years, they have been taking medicines for their whole family, even though they are practicing modern medicine. And there are many modern medicine practitioners, MD medicine, and all those who have converted to homeopathy. Means after doing their MD, they have done the graduation in homeopathy and they are practicing pure homeopathy.
That's the same in me. I was trained as a veterinarian, only conventional medicine. And then I fell so ill that nobody could help me. Only homeopathy could save my life. And then I converted.
Yeah.
That's the normal way.
Yeah. So unless we experience, we don't come to that way. No? Mm-hmm. So this is the thing that many of the modern medicine practitioners, they have experienced the success of homeopathy when their own family members have been affected with serious disease and they have been cured by that homeopathy. Then they came to this way that they mm-hmm. wanted to practice only homeopathy, and then they are very happy practicing homeopathy.
How did you meet homeopathy?
Yeah. To tell about me, my grandfather was a lay homeopathic practitioner. He just read books and he used to practice. And at that time, there were no colleges also. You know, that he had one book with him, which was written by Mueller. You know, he was a missionary at Mangalore, mm-hmm. a Christian missionary. At Mangalore, and he was practicing homeopathy, and he had written some books, and my grandfather got those books, and he was practicing at our native place. Mm-hmm. And there are no doctors in my family; only he was a lay homeopathic practitioner. And what happened? That book fell in my hand somehow through my father, because my grandfather passed away. But that book was with my father. And when I was in school at that time, I used to read this book and I used to wonder that, what is all this about? Later, I did my graduation after my marriage. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. So, what happened was, after my 12th standard, I was searching for to do some professional course. And as I was married and I was already having one kid, so I couldn't not able to do my doctor's graduation to some other state. You know, it was far away from my home. So my husband wanted to stay nearby to my place, in my home, and do a course which is available to nearby to my house. So the college which was nearby to my house was a homeopathic medical college. And even though I was getting a seat in the Ayurvedic college, even we tried to get an MBBS seat in Gulbarga. Mm-hmm. But in Gulbarga, they were asking for a lot of donations. Even I was getting the seat in MBBS, but they were asking for a lot of donations. And Gulbarga was very far away from my house. So my husband said, no, let us search somewhere nearby. And nearby in Mumbai, I was getting seat in Ayurveda, free seat. Mm-hmm. But then again, it was about 5 to 6 hours distance from my house. So again, that was not agreeable. So immediately in front of my house at a distance of 2 kilometers, there was a homeopathic medical college. So I got the admission there and I did my graduation from that homeopathic medical college. After doing the graduation, I joined there as a demonstrator mm-hmm. in human anatomy. Actually, I was interested in a homeopathic subject, but unfortunately, there was no vacancy in the homeopathic subjects, and I had to teach human anatomy. And for 18 years, I taught human anatomy there, and I was a rural OPD in charge, and I was taking care of the rural OPD there mm-hmm. in the medical college, and about 200 cases we used to see each day.
Wow.
In our rural OPDs. So that was the situation.
200 cases per day. This is fast prescription.
Yes.
You have to be very fast in prescribing if you see 200 people per day.
Yeah, so there were really acute cases. We have specifics also. We study the cases in different modes, you know. So mm-hmm. these rural OPDs were situated in the peripheral schools. Mm-hmm. And we had regular school students who used to come to us. and the teachers were there, and the people from the nearby villages, they used to come to us. So totally, those people used to regularly come to us, so we knew the history very well.
Okay.
So it was easier for us to prescribe.
That's fantastic.
Yeah. Hmm. So we can, in this way also, you can adopt the schools, you can adopt the some organizations where many people work, and then you can give the homeopathic medicines. In this way also, you can make a good documentation of cured cases and how homeopathy works. If you, in your country, if you want, you can do this way. So that was one way we used to do, because this was a compulsory thing, which was through the our CCH. At that time, CCH was there, Central Council of Homeopathy.
Mm-hmm.
So they had made it mandatory that you have to at least take 200 cases. And there was no option. We had to adopt the schools, and from the schools, we used to get the patients.
Okay.
And weekly or monthly, once or twice, we used to conduct medical camps also. Mm-hmm. So in this way, we used to obtain the patients also. This was mandatory. And this record, we had to send it to the Central Council of Homeopathy, that we are treating so many cases every day. This record we used to send.
Okay, so this
even now the practice is there. Even now we at the medical colleges level, academics level, we send them the record. Monthly record we send.
Yeah.
And daily inspections also conducted to see whether things are going on in a proper way.
This is totally different to Europe, where we don't have these many cases and no government standing behind us. It must be fantastic to be a homeopath in India. Such a freedom of work.
Yeah, it's fantastic. And there is lots of awareness through media, testimonials given by the patients who are getting cured. You know, we conduct many conferences at national levels, at district level. There are conferences where all the homeopathic doctors attend. They discuss their presentations. They discuss the research done by them. And they also discuss the successful cases. All that we discuss. Regular CMEs, continued medical educations for the doctors, are also being conducted in homeopathy. Then, as I said, there are homeo cases, case study circles, where we at a certain area, there are a group of doctors, they come together, they study the cases. So this is also being done. Research papers are published mm-hmm. in local magazines and all. National magazines, international papers are also being submitted. So these are some of the things which are being done. So now we'll come to another topic, that is how the homeopathic faculty in India, they have a lot of differences, you know. So decrease this number of differences, we all feel in India there is a lot of sentimental attachment to our doctor, Master Dr. Hanuman. You know, we all consider him as our guru.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a lot of emotional attachment. No? So there are, in spite of having this lot of emotional attachment, people argue on the principles of homeopathy, which are mentioned in the Organon of Medicine.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Some doctor is practicing specifics, some doctor is prescribing tinctures, some doctor is giving external applications. There are different modes of treatment, you know. In homeopathy itself, the people practice in different way as they feel necessary for the patients, you know. So in this way, there is a lot of differences. One doctor will say that doctor is not practicing this way according to the principles. This doctor is not practicing according to the principle. Some doctor is practicing the Kent's way. Some doctor is practicing classical Hanuman way. So there is a lot of differences in this way. One thing I feel that when we think that Dr. Hahnemann is our guru, we have an emotional, sentimental attachment. Whenever we feel somebody is our guru, we study the history of the guru, isn't it?
Yeah.
We know his life history. We know what an amazing person he is. You know, he is an alchemist. He is a doctor. He is a master of so many languages. He was a translator. He was, first of all, a big experimentator. No, he used to do experiments. He used to explore things. Are we adopting those things in our life? We have to question ourselves. Mm-hmm. You know, he has given us a lot of scope for experimentation. You know, when we are competing, when we are thinking that there is something like conventional medicine is there, how conventional medicine is growing and why homeopathy is staying behind? Why we are having that narrow-minded approach?
Yeah.
We have to be open-minded. We have to explore. We have to innovate. Okay? I'm not asking to leave the principles which are given by Dr. Hahnemann. Okay? The principle, basic principles be there. We have to follow those principles. But we have to explore things. When we study the 5th edition and 6th edition, we see lots of references there. You know, some differences have been made by his second wife.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so we have to see that even the changes have been made. That means he was open to exploration. He was open to innovation. So our people, we have to be open for the innovations. We have to experiment. We have to do lots of changes. We have to bring in some changes. Even we should be open to revise the organon of medicine.
Mm-hmm.
We have to bring in some more things which are of more of the naturalistic view, which are based on the nature's principles, and introduce it there.
Yes.
The science is a always evolving process. So we have to adapt to that. We have to evolve, keeping the natural laws in their place. We should not avoid those natural laws which have been given. So, keeping them in the place, we have to adapt to changes also. We have to be open for exploration. That is what I mean to say. And we should not argue on these silly things. And these silly things that you are arguing are being placed in front of the people who don't know anything about homeopathy. And they say that these people don't have any unity.
Mm-hmm.
So, this is one point, very important point. This is a very important point. If we want to succeed at the international level, if we want to come into the scientific society, we should be open-minded.
I agree.
And open for innovation and exploration.
I think this is what Hahnemann would have wanted, because he was an experimental mind, and he knew that that change is natural.
Yes. So that is what people have to realize, and keeping the egos aside, we have to sometimes agree to disagree.
Yeah.
So this thing has to be adopted by all the homeopaths. Let us all get together and unite, keeping aside our different views and coming to achieve a common goal. A common goal to come together into the scientific society and prove homeopathy scientifically.
Mm-hmm.
No? So that is the thing. For getting together into the scientific society, you know, we have the Ayush ministry here. There is a Quality Council of India, you know, Quality Council of India, which regulates the quality healthcare. Quality healthcare, not only for the conventional modern medicine, but also for the Ayush medicine. There is the NABH, National Accreditation of Bureau of Hospitals,
mm-hmm.
Which comes under the Quality Council of India, which is also working for the Ayush.
Yeah.
So that regulates the quality healthcare in the Ayush alternative medicines. This QCI comes under the JCI, okay, international mm-hmm. level. It is an international body, mm-hmm. JCI. So I think Ayush will expand to that level. the Ayush NABH, it will expand to that level, JCI. And once it goes to JCI level, homeopathy will get a chance to go internationally and to be accepted by the government.
You think that it will be internationally accepted?
Internationally accepted. So it will be internationally accepted once the Ayush NABH goes to JCI level. There are chances that in coming years that it will approach. Now, coming to how to place a strong evidences. You know that we already know that homeopathy is evidence-based medicines. We have lakhs and lakhs of evidences where cure has taken place. Even in the cases of cancers, we have people show so many cases in conferences which we attend. We see that so many cases, cancer cases, have been cured. There are testimonials given by those patients. You know, there are celebrities, there are politicians who also give the testimonials. They give the evidence that we have been cured by this. You know, that is why Indian government has accepted homeopathy into the this thing, government policies. So all the evidences have to be collected from these politicians or celebrities or lay people or our individual patients, from the private doctors. All these testimonials, all these evidences, the cases have to be collected. A big encyclopedia should be made. It will make a huge collective database, and this can be produced to your governments also. In your country also, if you do this way, obviously, I think your government will also think over, isn't it?
Our testimonials will be a big part of a game changer.
Yeah.
This is why I'm collecting interviews at the moment. I'm collecting articles, I'm collecting studies, and I'm collecting testimonials.
Yeah.
So, and I'm collecting as many as possible.
So that is one of the thing, collecting a huge database of the cases. Then coming for the cases which have been cured, the corona cases which have been cured in India as well as other countries. You know that Dr. Rajan Sankaran is there. There are many other stalwarts who are practicing homeopathy on a huge scale and with much popularity. You know? So now arsenic album 30 has been given. Apart from that, camphor 1M has been given according to the symptoms seen in the patients. Then CPR 200 has also been given by one of the homeopath in India. That has, because of the symptoms of, you see, some people are against that. I don't know why, but it seems to be working, because CPI, you see, there's a lot of indifference.
Mm-hmm.
You know, CPI is, in one way you can say, it is relevant to the mother nature.
Mm-hmm.
Mother nature. Sepia, if you study Sepia from Materia Medica, you see that it's a mother who has been burdened. Burdened a lot, and she has been bearing so many responsibilities, and later on she becomes totally indifferent.
Indifferent, you know? And before irritable.
Yes. So this is somewhat the case of Mother Earth, and even the personalities of the people, you know, because of the fear of that COVID-19. Yeah. You know, people are showing an indifferent attitude. They are forgetting their humanity. They are forgetting their compassion. Yeah. They are forgetting their love towards the fellow beings.
Yeah.
This is a totally indifferent attitude. And this is prominently seen in sepia. And in the same way, if you study many other symptoms also, you'll come to sepia at some point.
I see the point.
Yeah. So sepia also seems to be one of the good remedy for the COVID-19. Then you have bryonia. I'm sorry. Hmm. So bryonia 30 is there. Bryonia 30 and 200 has also been given on basis of the seasonal variation and the homesickness in lockdown, where people suffer from homesickness.
Yeah.
Then seasonal variation, because it was towards the December, January, where it is very cold and the days are hot, nights are cold, and that because of the season also, Brahmya has been given based on the symptoms, season. Then another, the arsenic, phosphorus, and tuberculinum based on the miasmatic theory. Yeah. This has also been introduced and being proposed to the government so that this will be, this should be included in the national health program for controlling the COVID-19. Yes, the APT, that is arsenic, phosphorus, and tuberculosis, based on the miasmatic theory. So this, some of these things have been adopted to control the COVID-19. Apart from that, people are also treating the COVID-19 cases who have been found positive, that is positive cases,
yeah,
based on their individual symptoms, taking the individual case history and hearing the symptoms. So many of the COVID positive cases have been found negative.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
If it's cured. After taking the homeopathic medicines,
mm-hmm.
They are turning negative. Yeah, and some hospitals in India have also been given permission, especially the government colleges or the colleges, medical colleges which come under the government, which are regulated by the Ayush. These medical colleges, Ayush medical colleges, have some of the homeopathic medicine medical colleges have been given the permission to give homeopathic medicines to the patients who are also under critical condition, who are under ventilators, who are in the ICU. These people are also being given the homeopathic medicines and the study is being done.
And it has been successful.
Yeah, and many cases are found to be negative after taking the homeopathic medicines. So there is a lot of debate on the genus epidemicus also, that whether the genus epidemicus has to be given or not given, because there is a total variation in the coming cases, you know. Even latest news is that China has introduced some G4 variant of the corona.
Mm-hmm.
So again, this gives some different types of symptoms. So when we see different cases, they are coming with different types of symptoms. Some are coming up with diarrhea, some are coming with loss of smell, some are coming up with the fever and headache and joint pains. So there is a lot of variations, you know? Mm-hmm. So that is why there is a lot of debate that whether the genus epidemicus has to be given or not to be given. That is one thing. So we can't consider the genus epidemicus at this point.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So people are considering some group of remedies which can be given to either prevent them or to make them immune to that disease. And treating the patients according to their individual symptoms. That is one thing which we are following right now here in India. Then, coming to the research. Research, in India, there is one Dr. Rajesh Shah is also insisting on developing NoSol for coronavirus.
Mm-hmm.
Coronavirus NoSol. And maybe that would act like a vaccine for coronavirus. So he is working on developing the NoSol, coronavirus NoSol. And as you know that in IIT Mumbai, the bioengineering department, where one doctor scientist is working on homeopathic medicines as nanomedicine.
Oh, interesting.
Yes. So that research is going on in IIT Mumbai. It is one of the top most Indian Institute of Technology.
Mm-hmm.
So that department is working on homeopathy as nanomedicine.
Has there already been done approving of the NoSol?
Approval is being done or not? I can pass on the number to you. You can contact him. I will pass on his email ID and number so that you can talk to him, and in detail you can talk to him regarding that.
Okay.
So finally, you know that truth prevails. We know that homeopathy is working well. We know we have the evidences. We have everything, but only is the cooperation from the government, you know, from your government. India also, it's working well, but somewhere we are still lagging. We want some more rights, because we have a huge number of colleges in India, and the number of students coming out from these colleges are also lakhs and lakhs in numbers. You know, so there should be a scope for their employment. There should be a scope for proving their medicine. So we want still more things to be done in India. Because what happens, because you may feel that the grass is green on the other side, but we still have some difficulties here. So we are working towards that, because our government is totally supportive. And in this, at this hour, where there is no medicine working, homeopathy is working very well. Mm-hmm. You know? So government is also supporting us very nicely. So this is the golden hour. As we know, it works. We also have evidences, research trial reports. So from our part in India, we are also pleading to the government. We are appealing to the government to introduce it into the mainstream, so that we homeopaths will be able to treat the patients in the COVID wards and in the ICUs along with the conventional system. You know, where the mainstream doctor should come together with the homeopaths, with the Ayurvedic practitioners, whatever the pathy. There should be no differences here, because we all together are working towards the humanity.
Yeah,
we are saving the humanity. So we want all together, all people to come together, all systems coming together and working cooperatively to save the patient anyhow. Here, our ego should not play. You know?
Yeah, I understand. But then the egos have to go aside.
Yeah. So we have to come together, treat them, and ask our Dr. Harshavardhan sir, who is our union health minister. Mm-hmm. He is elected as the chairman of the executive board of the WHO. So that is we are very fortunate to have him there. So I would like to appeal to Dr. Harshavardhan sir and our Ayush minister, Sripad Naik sir, to help us by integrating our Ayush system with the conventional medicine at the national, international, global level, so that we can alleviate the human suffering at the earliest.
Yes.
And that will be the good thing if this comes to the international level, because he is there in the WHO, mm-hmm. You know. So he can introduce Ayush, because Ayush is already part of the Indian government.
Yeah.
So there will be a collaboration of the Ayush medical system of India with the WHO. So through WHO, it will propagate to whole of the world, where homeopathy or Ayurveda or other systems, Yunani, Siddha, Yoga, all this will come together and will help in saving the COVID-19 patients.
Yes, it's a traditional way of treatment and living. We have our own style in Germany or in other European countries or even in the US. But and I know what you mean. It's the place of the traditional kinds of medicine for the betterment of the people.
Yes.
And you have to do something.
Traditional system is always there. In some things, like conventional medicine is doing, is also very good. Like they have their own sophisticated things, you know, instruments and all, where emergency conditions happen at that time. Even modern medicine helps in a way. But preventing some of the side effects of those sophistications, you know, homeopathy helps, like a mother's care, you know, when a baby is suffering. You give medicine, but mother's affection is not there. It will take a long time to cure. You know?
Yeah.
So it helps by caring the patient very smoothly and internally. You know?
Yeah.
So it helps in internal evolvement of the health. So that is how the traditional medicine helps. So let us wish that the WHO takes on the Ayush thing with them. And introduce it at a global level.
That would be very great. Really great.
And I also wish you the best for your endeavor of bringing the world homeopaths together for this collective evidence-based initiative.
I will try to join everybody at the table and to make them, I will try to make them stop the old quarrels.
Yes.
And to unite as one.
Yes, we have, first of all, we have to think positively and work with unity and for the common purpose of eliminating this novel coronavirus, not only from India, but also worldwide.
Yeah.
So let us come together. We have to show our actions and evidences by curing as many people as, and the government should also give a chance for us to work in hand in hand with the mainstream people, mainstream medical practitioners. That is what I wish.
I thank you very much.
Thank you so much.